Our opening hymn is hymn 388.
Thank you.
with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, in Christ you have revealed your glory among the nations. Preserve the works of your mercy, that your church throughout the world may persevere with steadfast faith in the confession of your name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Reading from the book of Isaiah. Surely God's servant has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases, yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray, we have all turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By a perversion of justice, he was taken away. Who could have imagined his future? For he was cut off from the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. They made his grave with the wicked and his tomb with the rich, although he had done no violence and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him with pain. When you make his life an offering for sin, he shall see his offspring and shall prolong his days. Through him the will of the Lord shall prosper. Out of his anguish he shall see light. He shall find satisfaction through his knowledge. The righteous one, my servant, shall make many righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will allot him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out himself to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and made an intercession for the transgressors. The word of the Lord.
Because you have made the Lord your refuge.
A reading from the Epistle to the Hebrews. Every high priest chosen from among mortals is put in charge of things pertaining to God on their behalf, to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. He is able to deal gently with the ignorant and wayward, since he himself is subject to weakness. And because of this, he must offer sacrifice for his own sins as well as those of the people. And one does not presume to take this honor, but takes it only when called by God, just as Aaron was. So also Christ did not glorify himself in becoming a high priest, but was appointed by the one who said to him, "You are my son, today I have begotten you." As he says also in another place, "You are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek." In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered, and having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him, having been designated by God a high priest according to the order of Melchizedek. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our sacred hymn is found in the Green Wonder Love and Praise books. It is number 810. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark. James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came forward to him and said to him, "Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask of you." And he said to them, "What is it you want me to do for you?" And they said to him, "Grant us to sit one at your right hand and one at your left in your glory." But Jesus said to them, "You do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink, or be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with?" They replied, "We are able." Then Jesus said to them, "The cup that I drink, you will drink, and with the baptism with which I am baptized, you will be baptized. But to sit at my right hand or at my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared." When the 10 heard this, they began to be angry with James and John. So Jesus called them and said to them, "You know that among the Gentiles, those whom they recognize as their rulers lord it over them, and their great ones are tyrants over them. But it is not so among you. But whoever wishes to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wishes to be first among you must be slave of all. For the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many." The Gospel of the Lord.
The Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Surgeon General has determined that smoking is dangerous to your health. This plastic bag is not a toy. Keep out of the reach of children. Caution, do not use this product around water. Danger of electric shock. The viewer is advised that the following program contains language that may be offensive. This toy is not suitable for people under 5 years of age. Life is dangerous. As a result, many of the products and services we encounter come with warning labels. The conversation among James and John and Jesus suggests that perhaps Christianity, following Jesus, should come with a warning label. This is what Jesus does in today's gospel. He's warning James and John and the other 10 of the dangers of following him. At the outset of Mark's gospel, Jesus saw James and John in the boat mending the nets with their father, and he called them, and immediately they left their father in the boat and followed Jesus, a shocking thing to do. In the words of an old hymn, they decided to follow Jesus. They took the first steps of discipleship. They accepted the call of Jesus. Good for them. But they have not yet come to maturity of life in him, as is clear from what they now say. "Do for us whatever we ask." right. What parent would agree when the child says, "I want you to do what I'm going to ask you"? Most sensible adults would respond, "I need to know what you're going to ask before I answer." And that's Jesus' response. The disciples' request is for high stature and glory. And it's such an embarrassing request that when Matthew tells this tale, he has their mother ask it rather than the apostles. The request indicates that they don't yet understand Jesus' teaching on discipleship, that those who want to save their lives must lose them for the sake of the gospel, and that the one who wants to be first must be last and servant of all. And as he often does, Jesus here replies with the question, "Are you able to drink the cup that I drink and be baptized with the baptism with which I am baptized?" This question, with its focus on cup and baptism, is the warning that Jesus offers. In Hebrew scripture, the cup is an image or a metaphor for what God offers a person in life. It might be the overflowing cup of Psalm 23. "My cup overfloweth, I've got more than enough." But it might equally be the cup of suffering and punishment of which several of the prophets speak. For Jesus, the cup symbolizes a person's lot in life. And that's clear at the end of John's Gospel, in chapter 18, when Judas and the soldiers have come to Gethsemane to arrest Jesus, and Peter draws his sword to protect him, and Jesus says, "Put your sword back into your sheath. Am I not to drink the cup the Father has given me? Am I not to drink the cup the Father has given me?" Clearly, Jesus understood the cup to be what God assigned him, the cup of suffering and the death of Calvary. And Jesus is warning James and John, "Can you suffer as I have been called to suffer?" Likewise, baptism, to which Jesus refers, is not what we think of when we hear the term. Most of us think of the sacrament of baptism with a lovely squalling baby and adoring parents and godparents and a soon-to-be rather damp priest. As we know, the Greek word baptism means to immerse or to wash in water, and in Jesus' day, it characterizes priestly preparation for sacrifice. Washing was what you did before sacrifice. On the Day of Atonement, the high priest in the temple bathed before and after making sacrifice for the people. Water washings in Jesus' day were about the removal of sin and moral purity. Mark records that John the Baptist preached a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And we remember that Jesus had submitted to it. When Jesus speaks to James and John, he has not yet undergone the baptism. He speaks of a baptism he's not yet undergone. No wonder if he doesn't have in mind the priestly ablutions before sacrifice. Parenthetically, I think that's why the lectionary gives us Hebrews 5 with this gospel text, because in Hebrews 5, Jesus is compared to the high priest. In the context of a teaching on judgment in Luke's gospel, Jesus says, "I have a baptism with which to be baptized, and what stress I am under until it is completed." And here, Jesus issues a warning to James and John, "Can you wash in preparation for sacrifice? indeed can you wash in preparation for being sacrificed. Jesus warns James and John that what they're asking for is costly. The life of discipleship is not a life of lounging around in comfortable seats with Jesus in glory. It is a life of humility, of service, and of slavery, albeit to a cosmically compassionate master. The call to discipleship we now call Christianity should probably come with a warning label. In her book, Teaching a Stone to Talk, Annie Dillard gets it just right. It's madness to wear hats to church, she says. We should all be wearing crash helmets. The ushers should issue us life preservers and signal flares. They should lash us to our pews. To be a disciple of Jesus is to live as he lived, neither luxuriously nor powerfully, but dangerously. Jesus lived a quiet, presumably holy life in Nazareth until he was about 30 years old. It was so quiet and ordinary that we know almost nothing about it. And when he left home, he preached a message that confronted the religious and political establishments of his day. The way of life that he preached challenged the expectations about what a good life was in his day. And if we listen carefully, it does so in ours as well. To borrow from Isaiah, he was despised and rejected, a man of suffering, wounded for our transgressions, subject to perversions of justice, cut off from the land of the living, bearing the brunt of iniquities he did not commit. To be a disciple of Jesus is to live as Jesus lived. And how many of us really want to do that? Can we drink his cup or endure his baptism? We contemporary disciples of Jesus should be easily identified by our quietness, our humility, our forbearance, our service to others, our passion for God's justice, and by the quality that most identified Jesus himself, by our inclusive love. We all know, that living a life that is quiet and humble and serving and devoted to justice and loving, it's not going to make us successful in the world's terms. Indeed, perhaps paradoxically, it is likely to lead us into conflict, to lead us to be despised and rejected. The early church understood this. Matthew recorded these words of Jesus, "Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great." It is worrisome when we American Christians are not being persecuted, reviled, and slandered for Jesus' sake. It suggests that we, like James and John, don't yet understand discipleship. Yes, indeed, a Christian's reward will be great in heaven. Doubt it for a moment. But as Jesus makes clear to James and John, that reward is premised on some difficult choices some difficult experiences in this life as we strive to live as Jesus lived and to live as Jesus taught. Christianity should come with a warning label and crash helmets and seat belts. Amen.
Now that we have heard the word of God read to us, and the word of God interpreted to us from preaching, we should be ready now to stand and declare our faith by reciting the Nicene Creed.
In peace we pray to you, Lord God, for all people and their daily life and work,
for our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone.
For this community, Joseph, our president, Jim, our governor, the nation, and the world.
For all who work for justice, freedom, and peace.
For the just and proper use of your creation. Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth.
For Michael, our presiding bishop, Mike, our bishop, and Matthew, our bishop coadjutor elect, and for all bishops and other ministers.
For all who serve God in this church.
For the special needs and concerns of this congregation, remembering especially Bobby Schultz, Priscilla Sheets, Shirley Bailey, Father David Saylor, Stephen Spurlock, Mick Sinclair, Barbara Easta, Aaron Naughton, Sandra Guthrie, James Bach, Andy Boyd, Edward Rose, Lynette Sickles, Father Brian Shoda, and the Tony Yerko family. Hear us, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life, congratulating Sean O'Connell and Asia Gooley, who were united in marriage recently, and remembering those celebrating birthdays and anniversaries this week, including Andrew Brown, Emily Brown, and Jane and Glenn Gorsica. We will exalt you, O God, our King, We pray for all who have died, remembering Nancy DeSantis, in whose memory the flowers are given, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them.
We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Again, as you can hear, our new sound system is in, much bigger, thank you, David. It's much better than the old one, hooray, hooray. You'll notice that the disco ball is gone, so instead we have two really well-camouflaged, or four actually, well-camouflaged speakers, and we're very glad to have them. Second thing is, the next installment for the stewardship campaign is in your bulletin this morning. This one deals with sharing. And of course, we are always glad to share what blessings that we have from God with each other and with our church community. It is a reminder to you that all of you should have received a pledge card already. If you did not receive a card and would like one, you just need to call the office and Linda will send one out to you. Please carefully and prayerfully consider what you want to give this year for the church's work. And we have done an awful lot of work. If you read John's letter, we have done quite a lot to refurbish the church and other places and to carry on the mission of St. Matthew. It is important that we have funds to do that. So please consider your pledge very carefully. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God. The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For by water and the Holy Spirit, you have made us a new people in Jesus Christ our Lord, to show forth your glory in all the world. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection unto your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where, with Matthew and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation, by him and with him and in him in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom,
of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. In the sacrament of his body, send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Our closing hymn is hymn 477.